Hawaiian folklore stories the fable of the goddess Kuahu Pahau, who, along with little yellow shark, frolicked in an enchanted sea brimming with thousands upon thousands of magnificent pearl oysters. It was known as the mythical place where the gallant giants slept. They called their emerald blue water haven Pu'uloa. History tells us, however, that on December 7, 1941, at 0753 hours, the fabled world below the peaceful Pacific awoke to war. We know the enchanted oyster-laden bay of Pu'uloa as Pearl Harbor, a tropical paradise that 59 years ago suddenly went berserk beneath a quiet Sunday morning sun. 2,335 U.S. servicemen perished in a blitz of Japanese bombers and fighters bearing the imperial emblem of the rising sun. The bold red dots on their wings are forever engraved in the minds of those who were fortunate enough to have crawled out of that wreckage. Of the 1,178 wounded, there isn't a one who doesn't remember nervously watching a sky that had suddenly lost its innocence and would never again seem quite as blue or pure as it had the day before. On Battleship Row, along the east shore of Ford Island, anchored the mighty Arizona. She was one of eight battleships within the sleepy harbor. The USS Arizona's crew was raising the colors when the first wave of terror swarmed into the harbor. Japanese Commander Mitsuo Fuchida shouted, "Tora, Tora, Tora," which translates as "Tiger, Tiger, Tiger." His aerial command, consisting of 51 Val dive bombers, 40 Kate torpedo bombers, 50 high-level bombers, and 43 Zero fighters, attacked the slumbering Tiger. Torpedo bombs, slithering shark quick just under the surface of the water, raced to detonate against the iron hulls of the battle wagons. Half-ton bombs bombarded the decks and superstructures of the 100 ships caught off guard. The venomous machine guns of the Zero fighters, hunting those flushed from the flaming ruins, strafed the decks and jetties. The USS Arizona's menacing strength became her own demise. A bomb ignited her munition stores. The proud ship was savagely blown in half. She sank in 9 minutes, taking with her 1,179 brave men. Next to the crippled USS Maryland, the USS Oklahoma lay idle on her side, like a tipped-over toy left in a child's bathwater. The USS Nevada grounded herself in the bay's mud to keep from sinking. Defiant of the deadly hissing hazards ricocheting around him, machinist mate S. Zemanski boldly straddled the belly of the capsized USS Utah. Armed with raw courage and a cutting torch, the gutsy sailor was slicing an escape route for the men trapped within the sinking coffin. Fuel fires from one ship engulfed the next ship. Billows of black and gray smoke choked lungs and vision. Bulkheads exploded into flesh-ripping shrapnel. No place was safe. Then came the second attack. In total, Japan had employed 351 planes in the attack. The devastation had been so complete in the harbor and in the airfields that Japan's Admiral Nagumo called off their planned third strike. Japan had destroyed almost half of the U.S. Navy in a single blitz. However, even as Japan lamented the fear that they had only succeeded in waking a sleeping giant, it began. If Pearl Harbor is to be remembered as a day of immense loss, it should also be remembered as a day of great courage. It's a mistake to underestimate America's fighting men. They quickly mustered what strength they could out of the chaos, the smoldering wreckage, and themselves, spit in the devil's eye and gave chase. Anything that could still float and build salt water poured out of Pearl and spilled into the vast Pacific in search of the marauders. It was the beginning of a four-year bloodbath in the backyard of paradise. That was nearly 60 years ago. Myths and legends tend to dull and fade with time. I don't know if Hawaiians still tell of the little yellow shark and the pearl oysters of Pu'uloa Bay, but I do know we lost a lot of good men there, and that for most Americans, it's still the place where the gallant giants sleep.